This lesson is on constructing stem and leaf plots. This is a data plot that uses part of the data value as the stem and part of the data value as the leaf. The three steps are listed here, and you can record those in your notes. They'll probably make more sense after we demonstrate one in just a minute. We're going to arrange our data in order. We're going to separate the data according to the first digit, and we're going to use this leading digit as the stem and the digits that follow as the leaf. We're going to separate these using a vertical line. From this, then, we can analyze peaks and gaps in the distribution and get a better understanding of what's taking place with our data. You also can describe this like you would a histogram using the idea of symmetry or skewness. You can do compare two different data sets if they're similar to one another, some characteristic, and you want to compare the two sets using what we call back-to-back stem and leaf plots. They would share a stem, and then you would use the leaf part of one distribution set going toward the right, and those values in the other distribution set going to the left. And then you could compare the two sets and see if one contains higher values, lower values, if one has more gaps than the other, and look at those two different sets. A stem and leaf plot groups the data like a histogram, but has a very significant difference in that the individual data values can still be seen when we use a stem and leaf plot. The example that we're going to use for constructing a stem and leaf plot is the following. At an outpatient testing center, the number of cardiograms performed each day for 20 days is shown. Construct a stem and leaf plot for the data. So on day one of the 20 days, there were 25 cardiograms performed in that particular outpatient testing center. On the second day, there were 31, the third day, 20, and so on. And we want to construct a stem and leaf plot. So the first thing we would want to do is look at the values here and put them in order from smallest to largest. And I'm going to go ahead and group them according to the first digit. So the only single digit data that we have recorded here is 02. And then those in the teens would be 13, 14, and that's it. For those in the 20s, we have 20, 23, and 25. We have several in the 30s. We have 31, and we have 32 recorded four different times, and you have to write down those all four times. Then we have 33 and 36. We have 43, 44, another 44, and 45. We have 51, 52, and 57. And that should be 20 values, and I always count to make sure I haven't left something out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. So probably I've recorded those correctly. Then we're going to see that we have 0 as the leading digit all the way through 5. And so we're going to write that down in a vertical column, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, you want to make sure once you decided to start at 0 and end at 5, you would not want to leave any numbers out. So if for some reason when we did this particular stem and leaf plot, if there were no values in the 20s, you still would want to put a 2 in your graph. And it's because you don't want to have any gaps in there. And then we draw a vertical line, and then we record the leaves, and they need to be recorded from smallest to the largest in order coming out from the stem. And so it's 0, 2, so we write a 2 beside the 0. Then in the teens, it's 13 and 14, so you write a 3, a little bit of space, and a 4. We have a 20. 23 and 25. We have 31. We have 432, so we're going to write down four twos. 33 and 36. So we write down the 6. Then in the 40 row, we're going to put a 3, 2 4s, and a 5. And then in the row for the 50s, we're going to put 1, 2, and 7. Now, it's important that you are very neat and organized in this. Otherwise, you won't be able to determine anything about the look of the distribution. We sort of line these up in careful rows and careful columns so that each row is spaced out evenly. If you were to turn this sideways from left, take the top part and put it on the left-hand side so that you're looking at 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 across the bottom, you'll notice you have columns going up. So it looks very similar to a histogram. You could even kind of draw this in, not necessary, but just sort of to demonstrate what this would look like if we were to do bar graphs for this particular data. And if you turn this up, you can see that we have a symmetrical distribution shape. Now, if we had done a histogram, the bars would have represented the number of data values we had in that particular group. For example, the group in the 30s contains 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 pieces of data. So you would have drawn a bar to represent 7 as a frequency. But after we did that, we would not know that you had a 31, 4 32s, a 33, and a 36. Those individual data values disappear. But when we do stem and leaf, we maintain those individual values, so we're able to look at that in a little more detail. We can look at this and tell that our lowest number of cardiograms were 2 in a day. The highest number was 57. We can see that the mode, or the one that occurred most often, is 32. And we can see that we had more days where we had in the 30s. So that would sort of maybe help us plan out in terms of time and how many we sort of expected to have on any given day. Sometimes we need to create some sort of a key so that the person looking at our stem and leaf will know what we're talking about here. Usually we choose one of our data values. It doesn't matter which one. I'm going to choose the top, the bottom one, the last one, 57. I'm going to do 5, draw my vertical line 7, and say that that represents 57 cardiograms a day. That way I know when I read this, I can know that we had 20 in one day and 44 in two different days and 13 in another day. So often that's helpful for the person who is looking at your graph. This would be a stem and leaf.